All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's get started. Thank you for coming today to this late-breaking special session on Ebola. My name is Mike Christian. I'm the Vice Chair of the Disaster Network. I'm a critical care infectious disease physician in Toronto, Canada, and was one of the members of the executive that led the recent guidelines in mass critical care. We have with us today a great panel of people with a lot of expertise in disaster preparedness in general, as well as Ebola specifically. From just down the road in Dallas, Texas, we have Edgar Jimenez, who's been teaching about PPE for many years. From Emory University Hospital, we have Mike Connor. Next to him, we have Captain Navy retired, Denny Amundson, who's spent a lot of time in resource poor and developing countries. And then to his far right, Lewis Rubinson, who you also know spoke this morning. He's from Baltimore Shock Trauma and just recently returned from Africa. So I'm going to start the session just by giving you a very, very quick sort of background to help you think about preparing for your for Ebola in your ICU. Then we'll switch to the panel. We're going to spend the bulk of the session today hearing from our panelists and trying to get a good conversation going amongst them and with others who can feed in some questions on Twitter. So just to get started here, so I have no financial disclosures and will not be mentioning off-label drugs, and the opinion expressed are those of mine, not the Royal Canadian Air Force or the Government of Canada. So most of you are here because of this. This has probably been your world for the past few weeks. It certainly has been my world for the past few months, and that's this complete saturation of our media and lives in many ways with issues about Ebola. A lot of fear out there, a lot of concern, and a lot of unknowns, which is really why we put this session on today, to try and bring this information together and hopefully start to answer some questions and at least give you a way forward in terms of preparing your ICU. So some of the things to think about when you're in this setting and when you're thinking about preparing for the for a potential Ebola case in your hospital, whether it's a true Ebola case or even more problematic are the suspect cases, are issues around clinical leadership. Point of first contact, what do you do when that person first walks to the emergency department and says, I just returned from Sierra Leone and I have a fever? How are you going to handle that? How are you going to be prepared? What tests and investigations are you going to do? What can you do safely? How can you do them? What's the process? How do you have to change the usual process in your hospital? And what's essential to do and what's not essential to do and actually maybe more risky to do? Where to provide care. So if you have this patient, where in the emergency department, how are you going to isolate them? What's your plan? Do you have a plan? How are you going to think about these things? And if you have to admit the patient for further testing, or if they're a possible, or if they end up being a confirmed case, where are you going to care for them in your hospital? Is it going to be your ICU? Is it going to be a ward? Do you have a special isolation unit? What are the features that are necessary for those things? Lots of issues around PPE and infection prevention and control. Certainly one of the things that Edgar will be talking about today. Waste management. Sounds like an issue that physicians don't deal with a lot of the time. This is a huge issue in Ebola, especially when you quickly find out that no one wants to take your waste, and it's rapidly mounting up in the rooms that you're trying to manage these patients in. So we'll get some insights, hopefully, from our colleagues from Emory around things like that, and the need for having a plan and starting to have these conversations. Caring clinically for a patient, either with Ebola or also a suspect patient. Because you have to remember, in North America right now, the vast majority of patients that are suspect patients will not have Ebola, but they will have something wrong with them. That's why they're in your hospital. That's why they have a fever. That's why they're coming to seek help. And you have to try and be able to care for them, do it in a safe manner, and also effectively treat what is going on with them if it's not Ebola. So how do you monitor them? What do you do for body fluid control? Issues around life support. How do you provide life support if necessary? How do you do it safely? What life supports are appropriate? What life supports may be too high risk? Blood products. So this is actually a huge issue in terms of giving a patient with Ebola or a suspect case a transfusion, because you can't use your regular process for grouping and screening. It's too high risk. A lot of these are open tests that you can't do. So does your blood bank have a process in place and a system in place for identifying how they're going to transfuse this this population? How are you going to use antibiotics? And then finally, issues around transport. Many physicians are involved in interfacility transport or transport of a patient to your facility from elsewhere, potentially repatriation. What are the infection control issues? How do you handle that? How do you interface with your EMS services or your critical care transport services to handle this? So in terms of where to look for these things, so one of the places we'd point you to is the just published this month, the CHEST supplement on caring for the critically ill and injured during disasters and pandemics. It's available free online. It's 12 manuscripts, 267 suggestions to help point you in the right direction. And like I said, if you go to the website, it's available at no cost to download. The topics that are covered there are surge capacity, so things like what do you need in your ICU, how do you do that, what's the system in place that you want to have, how do you integrate with the structure of command within your hospital, evacuation, possibly less of an issue for this particular Ebola situation, but certainly has some issues for transport which may be of interest to you. Triage, again, and resource allocation, less of an issue, certainly in the Western world, hopefully, about these with regard to Ebola, but a concern elsewhere. Special populations, systems level planning, communication and coordination, business continuity, huge thing. When you have a patient with one suspect case in your emergency department or a confirmed case, can easily close down so much of your hospital and your practice, people having to close extra spaces. How do you maintain the rest of the organization and continue to care for all the other patients that still need care during this time? Legal preparedness issues, several of them actually do overlap with issues around Ebola. So, and then finally, ethical issues. So how do you balance the safety of healthcare workers with the need of the patients? And how do you address those issues in your hospital? And then finally, the last two chapters in the supplement are all focused on resource poor settings, which at the time, we identified as an important issue, but has really become the sort of the forefront of issues. And we have one of the authors of that supplement in our audience here today. So these are all important questions, and a lot of direction and answers can be given related to Ebola within the supplement. Some other resources you want to look at, I'm sure most of you have been to the CDC webpage. There's some great resources on there, and clinical guidance that's constantly updated. Emory has a link that you can get to that will allow you to log in and access their protocols, because they've been thinking about this for a long time. I think their unit's been in conception for at least 12 years or more, that they've been working on this and practicing and drilling and planning. So they've had a lot more time and a lot more effort to put into the thought about how to do this planning. So a lot of excellent pearls there. The European Center for Disease Control and Prevention has a number of very good resources. They have probably one of the better resources out right now in terms of accessing and planning medical evacuation for patients. That's recently published, just came out October 21st. Public Health England in the UK also has a number of good resources on their webpage. Two of them in particular, they have a really well thought out process for working up suspect cases and a nice management protocol and plan that's coming out that deals with a lot of the infection control issues in particular. In Canada, we are three societies, Canadian Critical Care Society, Canadian Association of Emergency Physicians, and our Infectious Disease and Microbiology Society, published back in August an interim report on clinical care guidelines, and we have a new report that's just coming out. Will be updated this week with a lot of the lessons learned from places like Emory and other areas. So this is the real framework that we tend to use when we're looking at preparing your ICU for disasters. We look at space, staff, supplies, or what we call stuff, also issues around standard of care, ICU expansion goals, and then resources. So this is what we're going to use in terms of framework for asking a lot of the questions of our panel today. Just to get things started, well, first off, if you're online or on Twitter, you can send questions into us on Twitter. So hashtag Ebola chest, and I have a couple people in the audience here that are going to forward the questions to me. So we'll be able to get your questions up front. And then I'll have Edgar start up. You can just do it right in there. That's fine. Yep. That's great. That way, there you are. They'll be able to capture you on the camera. So I'll just ask Edgar to start off and set a little bit of the background and context in terms of PPE.
If we could have the next set of slides, please. Well, thanks very much, and thank you for the kind invitation of having me here. And I hope that as we move along in this conference, we'll be able to give you some of the tricks of the trade of things that we have known for a few years and that are finally permeating our critical care community. These are obviously the guidelines that you have seen until very recently, where the CDC has been teaching us how to do this. For some time, I mean, some of the critical care community has been very concerned about this, because in the sequence that they had initially had, where you remove your gloves first with a naked hand, well, there's very serious potential for contamination of the naked skin there. So some of the things needed to change. Some of the courses that we have taught over the years have trained precisely avoiding this, as we're going to show you. And we're going to have a special demonstration at 12:15 at the exhibit area where the chess stand is. We're going to have two of our top instructors show you the proper donning and doffing of a PPE sequence using a PAPR, a powered respirator. So, and of course, as you remove this, once you have contaminated, everything else goes, right? Now, if you were not able to contaminate, I guess, on the first round, now you're going to, on the second round, as you remove your gown, you doff the gown, you have a naked hand, again, that's going to have the sleeve roll over. So this raised very serious questions, and even the fact that we had in 2003 in the SARS epidemic in Canada, where you have one of the world's most developed countries have problems with the recommendations that were existing then, and we needed to revise all these and see where we needed to go. And of course, like I said, all of these gets more contaminated. During the SARS epidemic, I mean, this is an illustration of how in Wanzhou and the Guangdong province they were dealing with patients, raised serious concerns about, I mean, bare hands and white coats and things like that within the patient. Even the chart is there, and there's something in the mask of this treating physician that I don't know how to describe what it is. As things got serious in Canada, you can see here, this is the group where Michael was working with, of Tom Stewart then in 2003, where you can see the layering that was required, double layers. I mean, they were using not only an N95 respirator and goggles, but they were using a PAPR on top of that. Well, we learned later, that the neck would be significantly exposed when you had aerosolizations. The thing is, in our ICUs, we do unnatural things to what otherwise would be a natural process. So the natural process of transmission is no longer valid in our ICUs, precisely because we do aerosolization. And this is just to see, this is from the SARS, I mean, how the healthcare workers and their contacts were paying a significant price. And this is in 2007 with H5N1 now, with the bird flu, where we were looking at what was going on with them. I had a chance to visit with them, and now they're using PAPRs. So that picture that you saw before, this has changed, and now they use this not disposable, the cleanable variety of the PAPR to go inside. They still use their white coats, unfortunately, but that's probably a little more respiratory protection. So there are two major directives that you have to keep at all times. One is your force protection and your facility protection. I mean, you need to make sure that people are safe when they're going to be treating for this patient. If you don't have safety, people are not going to show to work, they're going to call in sick, they're going to avoid at all costs because they want to put themselves in jeopardy and their family. So it's very, very important. So in Toronto, if you see the data here, 56% of all cases of SARS then were in with healthcare workers or their direct contacts. So this is something that's very important to keep in mind. And including Michael, you see there some of the articles that were published there. There's what's going on, that we're following proper regulations and we're still getting our people sick. So I think these are cornerstone studies in 2006 in the Canadian Medical Association Journal. There's a study from Jorge Zamora that showed very interestingly, they did a crossover between what's recommended and the new types of regulations when protocols when you're using aerosolization as a potential threat to guide your PAPR. And the crossover was 23 patients and 27 in the other direction. And you can see that using the CDC recommendation there, you had a 4% chances of getting contaminated the face. The neck, anterior neck, was 96% chance. The interesting thing is that 6% that you see in the PAPR variety, it is in the second layer that you have. And we will see that in more detail at 12:15. Posterior aspect of the neck, 18%. So if I show you here, with a glow germ. This is a substance that glows with ultraviolet light with And you can see, after you do an exercise, what has been contaminated, you see that the two areas where we would expect most contamination would be right around the wrist, like we predicted, and then with aerosols right around the neck. You can even see the contour of the N95 mask around the face of that technician. Times are important, and you have to also adapt for that. How you're going to respond to a code blue when it takes sometimes 6 or 7 minutes to be able to put, and in sometimes even when you're learning, may take up to 20, 30 minutes to be able to put one of these devices. So you need to adapt, and I'll show you some of the things that people have done. So the conclusions of this was that with ordinary gowns, these are inadequate barriers, that the technique is very important, even with highly protective devices, and you need to follow prescriptive. Just like a pilot could follow a checklist, and they have done hundreds and hundreds of landings and takeoffs. We are human, we may forget, we may do something a little different every time. We need to follow a very strict list of how do we don and how we doff to be safe. And that obviously that the removal is very, very important, because that's after you have been exposed and contaminated. Casanova had a similar publication in 2008, where he showed also that they often resulted in hands and clothing when you're using those recommendations. And we aerosolize. This is just a picture to show you. I mean, we put a BiPAP, we put a high-flow oxygen mask. We're aerosolizing in our ICUs beyond the 3-foot range that we think is so safe. So the tricks of the trade. Things that have changed now and that you have to keep in mind is do not use absorbable material in shoes. I mean, that's very important. And so we have, I guess, unfortunately, we don't have stocks in Crocs or anything like that. But you know, that would be one of the types of shoes. One of the other things that we have learned is the taping. We are taping longitudinally our gloves like that. And let me show you a little better there. You see the big band of tape between the gloves and the bunny suit? The reason why we have taught this at our FDM, Fundamental Disaster Management, for SCCM for almost 8-9 years is because it allows you to remove whatever gown or system you're using to protect your body as one unit with the gloves in one motion, as you see here. So circumferential taping right now, even in the regulations from the CDC, it is difficult because it's difficult to remove, but if you do longitudinal taping, in these situations, the gloves move a lot easier. Constant cleaning in between each steps, cleaning either with bleach preparations or alcohol, depending on what you have. Have enough PAPRs, you know, if you're going to have. I mean, this is something that should be a routine. If we have high contagious or significantly contagious, like drug-resistant tuberculosis or something like that, this should be something that should be more routine than having to use it every time we have something like this and people forget. The use of non-absorbent materials for the belts. This is, and we're about to finish, where you have the face mask that we used in the past. We no longer use that. We use the hood that covers the shoulders precisely to protect the neck in aerosolization situations. And using also oxygen devices that have HEPA filtration that prevent the aerosolization in the room. That's important also to keep in mind. We also have learned that in order to keep the PAPRs without any blockages, I mean, how you place them, we will be showing this, and this is some of our people, where we have found out exactly how to use the second gown or the coverall that you will be using on the second layer, that's even there by the CDC recommendations now, how to prevent it from obstructing your PAPR filters. What we did, if you see our Baylor Scott and White group, which covers the area of Dallas, we were very fortunately, and again, that we had a chance to prepare. But the other group, unfortunately, Texas Health, had a lot of problems, as you saw in the media, with their initial focus. It could have been anybody. We have 43 hospitals in an area that covers pretty much this area of the states of Massachusetts, Vermont and New Hampshire together, 43 hospitals and over 500 clinics. So it took a lot of resources. Things that you have to keep in mind is to use a hospital incident command system to be able to organize your resources. and to develop protocols pretty much for everything. This is just a few of the samples that we have of some of the protocols. We're going to be going directly over the treatment and healthcare worker for the healthcare worker and the coach protocol. And I want to thank you for the invitation. I think a lot of the resources, this is a cooperative session that we have also put together with the Society of Critical Care Medicine. And I want to thank also Baylor and Scott and White to allow me to participate here. Thank you so much.
All right, thanks a lot, Edgar. A little bit of PTSD flashbacks from SARS there for me. But let's get the question started. So Lewis and Mike, quick question from Edgar's talk. So clearly, you know, PPE is important, and Edgar mentioned that, you know, we're all humans. So in terms of training, and particularly human factors, issues in training, can you tell us about any of your experiences you had in terms of the training you receive or that you give for your staff and PPE, and what particular aspects of human factors you pay attention to that?
Well, first of all, I just want to, aside from thanking everyone for being here, I want to acknowledge our team at Emory as well. I am not involved in the administration of our sort of training program for PPE. There's the leadership of our unit that does that has organized all of that. We are sort of constantly retraining people. We have had our nurses who have taken care of patients and have had a lot of experience, but then when we had a gap of a week or two without patients, when the next patient came in, we re-went through re-education, retraining, refreshers, just to make sure that no one had sort of lost any information along the way. The training that I personally received was, I think, very similar to what Edgar sort of pointed out and what I think most people are doing in terms of the sort of full covering with the hood and the PAPR, and it was a several hours worth of going through sort of an extensive training program, donning, doffing. But it's still the first few times you do it, you still have to, every time you do it, you need to think through it. You need to have somebody coaching you, somebody watching you very closely, helping you with a checklist, I think is really important.
Yeah, I think there's an old adage in skydiving, it's not your first several jumps, it's your 101st jump that's always the most risky because
right.
You become complacent.
Exactly.
Lewis?
So there are a fair number of differences and similarities between care that are being done in Europe and the U.S. with the 18 or so patients who've either been medically evacuated back or people who self-presented with new disease versus West Africa. But I think that these issues are actually more similar than different. In West Africa, we had supply chain issues, but ultimately it was all about discipline and adherence. The first thing we did for discipline is we enacted no touch. So during my entire time there, you never shared a phone with someone, you never shared food, and you kept space. Now, of course, did that really prevent a lot of transmission? No, but the first thing it does is the early symptoms of when someone is getting sick who's a healthcare worker, it's mostly fatigue. And honestly, we're all fatigued when we're doing this. So it's very hard at first to know that you actually are infected. Second is GI disturbance, and anyone who's been to Africa knows that that's a recurrent problem, even when you don't have Ebola. So what we did is we enacted no touch, mostly just to create a culture of discipline. 24/7, you were on the game of we are not going to spread it to each other or to other people. The second thing, which I don't think has gotten as much attention here, there's been a lot on the buddy systems, but the buddy systems have mostly been suggested to be passive kind of observers to keep people safe. We did it very differently. When you came out of the Ebola treatment unit, the person who was helping you doff actually commanded you, and you did not do anything without them telling you. So whether it was your first time or your 100th time getting out of your PPE, you did not do anything without being commanded to. And that ensured that the human factor issues of heat, of just confusion, of tired, of the emotional strain of taking care of people were taken out of the equation. Someone else was telling you what to do, and they were watching you the entire time. The third is disinfection. And again, this is controversial. Out in Africa, it's very easy to spray bleach on each layer of your PPE as you're taking it off. but there's a fair amount of soiling that's going to happen on your apron, so your chest and belly, your hands, and your boots. And what we did is, rather than assuming that people are going to take it off in a in a way that doesn't cause self-contamination, we assumed that we needed to reduce the infectious burden on their PPE. So at every single step, you were resprayed with bleach. There are issues around aerosolization that are still controversial, and there are a variety of ways to do it and do it safely. But I think those are the components that I still haven't seen really come across to the U.S., and I wouldn't be surprised again if we change our recommendations again in the near future, because we're still always fighting the previous war rather than proactively really predicting what's the highest level we can undertake.
Yeah, thanks. Actually, it's a good point, and it was just second nature to us, but when we did all this training in the recently for the Canadian Critical Care Air Evac in the military, we do our donning and doffing just like that. Someone has a checklist. We're in the Air Force. Everything's done with a checklist, and they read through the checklist as you're donning and doffing. But that sort of keys me on to the next question, sort of moving to our other military colleague here. So, Denny, one of the things in linking to the Africa discussion, a lot of people are asking about now, as they're thinking about going to Africa, they're thinking about possibly volunteering for one of these missions. Any advice you'd have for somebody who's thinking about deploying to another country to go to a resource-poor setting? And then, Lewis, you can follow on with that afterwards.
Well, as you know, I usually learn the diseases by getting them, and I can tell you that's not the proper way to do it, having had dengue and hep C both over there. Certainly you have to know your threats, so you have to do a threat assessment. You have to, if you're going to go, certainly I laud that, and we were talking about altruism yesterday. I'm not sure I'm altruistic, but I wouldn't send anybody that to a place that I wouldn't go to, and that's a philosophy. But you have to be smart about it. You have to know that there's other diseases other than the one you're going to go attack, and that's the biggest thing that I found. At least I spent 6 months in the same area of Africa on the coast, and there's a whole bunch of other diseases that you have to recognize and be prepared for, and that's huge. Typhoid, malaria, and a whole bunch of things I don't even know. But it's preparation. It's going smart. You got to lose the I'm different kind of attitude. Same thing for the PPE. It's different when you do training to when you're there and trying to put it on. Your hands are shaking. You're sweating already before you get into things. Things don't go exactly like they do when you're training. I think this is from wartime things, when you're up against something that you don't know. It's a whole different attitude, and you're not any different. You have to lose that attitude and say, and I like the coaching idea. If somebody's there with a checklist helping me, that's what you need to do. And other than that, be safe, get your shots, and just know your threats, I think, is the biggest thing.
Hey, Lewis?
So how many folks have done disaster work with NGOs? My guess is probably some folks. So in Ebola, it's very different. If you go to an earthquake, you will see a variety of different alphabet soup from non-governmental organizations who've had a fair amount of experience doing a variety of things over past decades, and they're quite good at what they do. There's always a bit of dysfunction, but everyone knows they're generally pretty good organizations, and they handle the problems long after the media is gone. Ebola is very different. So really, over the past two decades, except for the World Health Organization, some of the government organizations, such as the Ugandan Army, DRC, et cetera, really, Doctors Without Borders is the only one who's had game in Ebola. So if you're going with an organization that's an alphabet soup that's different than MSF, you need to ask the next questions. The first is, are you ready? And by that I mean, it's fairly hot in the suits. If you get hot running 5-6 miles, you need to really ask yourself, is this appropriate? It is hot, and the last thing you want, if you have a heart attack in Kenema, you are not going to be evacuated fast enough. There's nothing to get you out with. So you need to be honest with yourself, are you ready? The second is, the operational posture in the supply chain. It's great if you're going to be doing PPE, but if they keep changing your PPE every 4 days because the supply chain changes, that puts you at risk. So you need to really ask the question of, do they have a consistent supply chain? Do they know what they're doing? The third is security. Unfortunately, most of these countries, it actually has been okay. There was some problems, obviously, in Guinea. There were some problems occasionally in Liberia. But on the most part, the security posture just needs to be thought of, and you need to make sure that if things change, that they know how to get you out. The next one is medical evacuation. Don't accept, we'll figure it out if it happens, how to get you out. That group needs to be plugged in and needs to be able to figure out that, because this is not a theoretical risk. You have to go there expecting that there is a chance you're going to get it. We do everything we can to minimize it, and that's not to be melodramatic. You'd be crazy to think that you're going to be different than any of the other very good healthcare workers who've gotten it. There's a lot of ways we can keep people safe, but on the most part, you really need to play that contingency plan. The last one I would say is, are they cutting corners? If you start hearing things like, yeah, you don't really need your yellow fever vaccine, you know, we'll figure that out, or yeah, it's up to you about malaria prophylaxis, I'd probably keep looking to a different group. Because anyone who knows anything knows the last thing you want is to be trying to distinguish between fever from malaria while you're out there, rather than something that could be obviously very different. So I think when you're doing the checklist, I absolutely think we need to get more people out there, but you need to do your schoolwork to make sure that you're not going into a place where you're going to be putting yourself at more undue risk than is necessary.
That's great, Lewis. Actually, I think a lot of those lessons also apply within North America as well for RCUs. Are you ready? You know, are you the right person to be in PPE, and can you cope in that? You know, don't cut corners. Supply chain and logistics are huge. So let's just come back to the North American setting for a minute then, and I'll pitch this one to Edgar and Michael. So staff is one of the, you know, we can't function in ICU without staff. Staff are important and critical to this. Edgar, maybe you start off just talking a little bit about preparations for staff. How do you prepare your staff if you're, in addition to training for PPE, but the other aspects of getting them ready to potentially manage a patient with Ebola, and then Mike, you can carry on from that.
I think what we have learned is a combination of things. I mean, it has to be from keeping them well informed, making sure they feel safe, using social media. Everybody is, we're doing webinars and everything. There has to be a psych situation, you know, where people feel comfortable and when dealing with this. It is amazing to see the amount of people that volunteered. I mean, even knowing the problems that we had, they said, we want to be part of the team. And then they go through the training. I mean, this is not a rinky-dinky training. I mean, this is a scheduled training where they go, like Mike was saying, over and over with donning, doffing. And like we were mentioning earlier, very specific sequence. We have upped this to having three people, one outside the room where they're going to be donning or doffing, that is the observer, and someone that in a different type of PPE is helping the healthcare worker get in and out, but they choreograph this. Every step is described, and they follow it to the letter.
Michael, and then actually, Denny, why don't you go first?
Well,
and then
I just wanted to ask a question. How many
job.
People? Yeah. Oh, that's your job. Well, no. How many people in the audience have a special team that will do this? So some
of
you
like
already set
25%.
Yeah, 25%. How many of those are volunteers? Couple, yeah, about the same. Okay. How many people think their staff will show up if you have an Ebola case in your ICU that day? Okay, about 25%. So does that mean that 75% of you don't think your staff are going to show up? All right. I just wanted to get a... I'm not sure yet. I'm at Scripps in San Diego. They're all out surfing, so I'm not sure who'll show up.
Yeah. Actually, you know what? Just to one thing. So there actually have been some really positive things, at least I've seen so far. We had a high-risk suspected case recently, nurses in the ICU that were involved volunteered to come down, A, to look after the patient, then other nurses volunteered to come down and help with the extra burden of having, you know, increased nursing staff for that one patient. So at least where I am, I've seen a lot of positive things, and I'm sure from your experience at Emory, you can share some of the things about what allows your staff to function and how it's functioning right now.
Right. Well, we have a self-contained biocontainment unit. So our patients, anyone who is high risk, who is getting admitted through the emergency department, which we've had a couple, or anybody who we've evacuated and brought in, are treated in the biocontainment unit. So they're not necessarily somebody who happens to be in an ICU with other patients around. We have only volunteers. I think it's important to recognize that just because they volunteer, it doesn't mean that they should be hired to be part of the team. I think you have to make sure that you still make sure that they're qualified to be part of the team, because people might have the best of intentions, but they might also not be the best at their job or the most attentive to details. And so I think you have to ask around, is this person who's volunteering, are they someone that can be counted on in their current environment or not? And the second thing is, we only use intensive care unit nurses. We do have a couple emergency department nurses as well, but really high acuity settings, because if the patients do progress to critical illness, we need people who have that capability to do that. The one thing I did want to say is I think that you have to also remember that all the planning in the world is great, but and I really applaud all the planning that's happened in your institution and training. But at the same time, when one of these cases do come in, it's sort of the first time they come in, it's sort of anarchy for a little while. You know, it's the patient or is running sort of the asylum at some level. Like it's every, you know, first of all, you also have about a million administrators who have showed up who haven't gone through the training and may be introducing some additional risk, and then you have media all over the place, at least right now. So it's you have to realize that the best laid plans might not work right away, and you have to plan and realize that we have to keep this sort of small. We have to realize that it might not work, and we have to have backups for the backups, I think is the best thing.
One of the things the more I've been going through this whole Ebola situation just reinforces for me as to how many parallels there are between just every other disaster. You know, any disaster occurs, any war occurs, you know, no plan survives first contact with the enemy is what some famous general said at one point. But, and it's the same for so many disasters. You know, you plan, you have these preparations, but when it actually happens, you have to have leadership on the ground. You have to have processes in place that you can fall back on. So, Lewis, and then the rest of the group, since you've been involved in disaster planning a lot, any other sort of just nuggets that you can think of from just disaster planning in general that you think really apply to the Ebola situation will help people get through this?
Well, the first thing I'll talk about probably applies most to staff. So we just heard a lot of great suggestions on how to get staff there. I think it's also worthy of saying things that's probably things that are best to avoid to make sure that staff don't run away. I think probably the quickest ways you can make your facility fall apart is one, be too quick to reassure, right? The reassurance we've already seen from some elements of public health and the federal government were incorrect. Now, they were basing their reassurance on uncertainties, which is reasonable. But if you give someone reassurance that ends up being wrong, you have just violated their trust and the whole thing spirals downhill. So say what you know, say what you don't know, but it's still okay to do something based on what you don't know if there is either consensus or it just makes sense from a safety issue. But people can't be told this will never happen and then 2 days later it happens because the whole thing unravels. The second thing is wherever you take care of your patient, it is crucial that you identify a hot zone and that is never violated. All of your first principles have to be about keeping Ebola where you know it. So I worked at a place where that all fell down in Kenema, and just the assumption was anywhere was high risk. When that happens, all of your processes start to fail. your staff become very concerned because you don't know where the risk is. If you can keep the risk ahead of you and you know where it is, they can be on their game day when they get there. If, for instance, you start using visitors because you just think it's the right thing to do, well, think about what you're asking a visitor to do. You're asking them to learn how to use PPE and be 100% adherent while they're caring for their loved one who's potentially dying of a terrible disease and not to spread it to your facility. I think that's actually a non-starter. There are a lot of people, especially with pediatrics, who would argue with me, but I've seen that spread outside of your risk area. And if you lose control of that risk area, you've lost control of your facility. Again, everyone, even the best people who really were willing to step up, will start to shy away because they no longer have faith that this thing is a controllable issue. And so Mike talking about first principles of disasters, I think risk communication is key. I think the leaders need to be there, but they also need to listen to their team. If the leaders are trying to use political policies to drive the clinical team to do something that they feel is unsafe, that's a very, very difficult position to be in. And that will happen because there are a lot of pressures, external pressures. So really what the leaders need to do is they need to follow incident command and they need to allow people who are on the operational end to make decisions without politics involved. Again, I think if folks feel like things are being done to them rather than being engaged in why they're doing them, then they may head for the hills.
Edgar?
Yes, I think it's very important to keep in mind that to be able to deal with anything like this, you need to be organized. And I couldn't stress even further about having a unified command where you have different, you know, divisions, I mean, where you're going to be able to control this. The information, as they were mentioning here, is very important, and what you deliver to the people. When you have our example, for example, we have over 16,000 employees, and I said we cover dozens of counties. To have that unified command webinars and everything that keeps everybody on the same page is very, very important, because you're getting all these side efforts and side conversations and things that deviate from what the core should be. So it's very important, and you need to control for communities that are in panic. So your conversation not only should be with the people you care for within your institution, but also what are you going to deliver to the community? So keep the, because when you have panic like this at this level, people start doing funny things. You have someone that has a regular disease that is not even a very low risk, non-threat, and you have paramedics that show up in full PAPRs to pick up this patient and bring it to the hospital that's not waiting. That happens to us because one of the sheriffs in one of the counties decided to inform that this may be a highly contagious case that was absolutely nothing to do. So you have all this going on, the panic from airports, you know, from people traveling together. You have to learn how to control that, and the only way to do that is having a unified command.
That's great. Thanks. Michael, did you have anything to add to that? Right. I have a question about for Michael then about the more the clinical management. Having looked after a few patients in the Western setting, you know, we've heard a lot about there's growing body of literature out there about how to manage patients in Africa in the resource poor setting. But there's only been a handful of cases that you pointed out earlier today, 18 cases that have really truly been managed in a sort of Western medicine type of setting. Any pearls of wisdom that you have from this sort of tips for clinical management and things to think about as you go forward? I know it's a long list, but maybe a few.
The gastroenteritis is rough. Be prepared for how to handle voluminous amounts of diarrhea and to make sure that you have an appropriate way to provide volume resuscitation to those patients. I think we at least have decided to focus mostly on sort of a balanced crystalloid resuscitation, really not so much a colloid resuscitation, having the appropriate vascular access that's secure, that doesn't have a lot of risk associated with it. We don't want to be putting fresh IVs in every 2 days. We don't want people to have that risk of sort of needle stick. So if you're going to accept the risk of a needle stick, put in a central line and just keep it sort of thing one time. The disease evolves. Some patients develop critical illness. and those patients can be safely treated with life support therapies. They can receive mechanical ventilation. They can receive renal replacement therapy. We would argue for CRT, even if they're healthy, for a variety of reasons, which are pointed out on a new CDC guideline that we collaborated with them on. What else? What else did we talk about this morning? Keeping healthcare workers safe, I think, is really the key. If you're going to do advanced care, you have to do advanced care in the setting of safety. So you have to say, how does this mechanical ventilation impact safety? How do we prepare for the fact that if he self-extubates, the cavalry is not coming for 15 minutes until they get in PAFR or in their PPE, I should say.
Yeah, Lewis?
The first thing I would say is you will not be impressed by how ill these patients are. You see much sicker patients every day. Even when they're moribund, I was like, wow, this is it? Really? You expect just to see a lot more. So at most folks who are practicing intensivists will see that there's not much shock unless they have secondary infections. And their organ dysfunction is nowhere near the extremes of what we can manage. Generally, it's manageable.
It's nowhere near the extreme of somebody with H1N1 and ARDS
and
multi-organ failure and on ECMO. I mean, it's not that bad.
Right.
But it requires a lot of attention for safety, and that's very fatiguing.
And that's exactly right. And the attention for safety requires the clinicians to be involved. One sec, let me just finish my point.
Yeah, we're going to take questions in a little bit.
Okay. And the reason why it requires all of you to be involved is because if folks who don't do are making decisions, so for instance, you only get so many options with your point of care testing, right? So you need to either think about what you're going to do for the patient and develop the requirement for the point of care test and then decide, can it be done or not? Or it's going to be handed to you and you're going to find out that someone decided that coags are too hard to do and someone who has viral hemorrhagic fever, doesn't get coags. So you don't want to be caught in that situation, right? And the third thing is, usually we have a myriad of diagnostics that are available to us. You're going to need to be creative, mostly around bedside ultrasound, on what you can do, right? We can do optic nerve measurements and get ICP. We can probably do fairly good judgment at, is the endotracheal tube placed properly from just you have slide on both sides, right? There's ways, but you need to just do the mental exercise in your head. And for us, the biggest thing we really struggled with was labor and delivery issues. Who's going to take care of the neonate afterwards? And an adult intensivist shouldn't be making that decision, right? So it's going to the experts who can actually speak to what is necessary and what is over the top, so that you make sure you're providing appropriate care, but not unsafe care.
So one of the questions you've just had coming in as well follows on nicely with that. But equipment, so what are you doing with your equipment, particularly life support equipment afterwards, ventilators?
That's a great question. Officially, we don't have a lot of great guidance yet from national organizations on exactly how to handle that. The equipment can be disinfected. This is not a virus that sits on fomites for a very long time. So what we have done is our equipment, any equipment that we've used, all remains in the room. And fortunately, our room is not very large, but large enough that if we end up finishing use of the dialysis machine, it can sit in the corner until such time that it's disinfected. And then after the patient is discharged, the whole room, at our institution, we're doing sort of a vaporized hydrogen peroxide treatment of the whole room, which a specialty contractor performs, and then the equipment sits for a rest period for several days. I think it's 7 to 10 days, and then at that point, it will return to usual circulation. We have not had the liberty yet of having a free enough time period where we haven't had patients to where we've returned anything yet to circulation, but that's our plan. We're not discarding.
Okay. We'll move on to questions from the audience in just a minute. Just last question, so from the panel. So we'll just go across to see if there's anything else you wanted to contribute. But also, if you get a minute, particularly for Lewis and Michael, what do you do for yourselves during this? How do you take care of yourselves when you're looking after these patients, and what do people need to think about?
So I think taking care of yourself is, it's a struggle. Obviously, in West Africa, you don't have the same support group as you do at home. Fortunately, I had a really good team. The one thing I was truly hoping is that they had hoppy beer, but unfortunately, I had to imagine an IPA in my head at night to be able to get to sleep. It's hard. Again, it's really about your team. It's just like everyday ICU dynamics. Do you go home and do you feel good about the group you worked with or not? I fortunately work in a great place with really good people. And even when you're in a chaotic and difficult environment, that provides so much additional support to be able to work through it. If any of you go to West Africa, you will see terrible things. You just will. And many of them you can't imagine unless you've been in there before. But you get past them, mostly because your colleagues are going through the same experiences and they're good people. And when you need to talk about it, you do. And when you need to be silent, you are. So I think, again, the key thing is you can't go through this alone. It's a pretty traumatic period. The flip side, I would say, is when I came home, it was just as the Dallas cases were happening. There's fairly high risk of giving our providers PTSD from coming home and shaming them into thinking that they did something wrong and they need to be removed from society for 21 days. So just, again, I get the public health issues, but it's very, very difficult. Even nowadays, I have a fair number of colleagues who won't shake my hand, and I'm well outside of the quarantine period. We love each other.
Michael?
No, Michael. I was just going to say, Lewis, that I think we all said to be careful not to have that same shaming of people who are taking care of patients here, too, especially if we have more patients. I think that people that make policy need to think about the ramifications of this sort of stuff, because taking care of these patients is hard. You need rest, you need sleep. I think we as physicians a lot of times don't like to admit when we need help. You need to, not be afraid to ask for help. But then if you're also told you can't go home to see your kids, you have had no obvious high-risk exposures other than just being in the room with the patient. There's been no spills of blood. There's been no stool everywhere, or anything like that. You haven't had any violations in your PPE, but you can't go home to see your family or kids for 21 days. I think that will be... there will be a lot of people who won't be signing up for this anymore. And not to mention the financial aspects of that and everything. So I think we have to be very, very careful about that. I think you have to be not afraid to ask for help, be willing to admit if you think that you have had a violation. You have to recognize you still have to protect other people if you're going to do this. But at the same time, the society has to protect you and has to help you. And I'm not sure we've reached that balance yet.
Yeah, there's a lot of lessons. We lived this during SARS as well, and there's a lot of good lessons from those days we need to dust off and revisit. Denny?
No, I want your questions, but just another behavioral thing. At least where I'm at is there's a tendency to stovepipe planning, and there's a tendency to ask the infectious disease person, to take on, and the critical care people take thinking that these people are smart people and will figure everything out. But this is really a continuity of care. There's going to be dead body removals. There's going to be all sorts of things that you have to plan for. And unless you step up, because you are, and most of us are pulmonary critical care, you're going to have to get involved. And there's a tendency to step back and think that it's all going to be planned out. And I think if anything I can say is that you got to step forward. You got to say, I know a little something too. And not allow somebody else to make decisions where you are going to put you and your staff at risk to do. I would prefer to have somebody else making those decisions alongside that infectious disease person who's been in that environment and has had that exposure. That's what I would recommend, absolutely.
Yeah, that's great. And we recommend that all through the supplement as well, sort of the need for critical care leadership in these. And yeah, I guess I have that split personality. One side of me talks to the other side. The ID talks to the critical care side. Edgar, last comment, and then we'll move to questions.
Safety. Think of safety and organize with a very established structure. And whatever steps you're going to take, make sure they're well described and that can be followed well by everybody. Communications also is going to be very, very important as you move along.
Okay, so I'm going to play Donahue for a minute. And if you just keep your question quick and into the microphone, we'll get...
Hi, Chris Carroll from Connecticut. I've heard people say to me that we should not be providing critical care services for patients with Ebola because they're all just going to die. That meaning you shouldn't ventilate them, you shouldn't put IVs in them, you shouldn't, God forbid, put an IO in them because that's going to cause aerosolization of the spicules. How would you respond to that?
I would completely disagree.
Yeah.
I think that critical care can be provided safely, but it has to be done. You have to be flexible, you have to be resourceful, you have to make do with a little bit less than we do, and you have to think about every intervention before you're going to do it. But I absolutely think that it can be provided safely, and with appropriate critical care, mortality in the developed world should not be anywhere near where it is in Africa.
And that's actually based on real experience, right? So both the Emory experience as well as experience in Europe, they've been able to bring people through full organ dysfunction and back to survival and being normal people again. So I think had we not known, or let's say that it looked like most of the folks that we still provide supportive care still go on to die, I think that's a reasonable conversation. But that's just not our experience right now. So I think places need to draw limits. Right. For instance, this morning Michael talked about ECMO, and we saw ELSO came out with a statement. Partially, I was like, no duh, but still, I mean, at least our cannulations never seem to be blood-free in our facility.
Okay.
I think it's very reasonable to provide critical care, but it's not all or none.
Right.
It's appropriately decided based on the organs that are most likely to fail and the ones that we can actually treat in a way that doesn't seem to put staff at too undue risk.
That's
so just, I mean, it's well known at this point that we had a critical ill patient who was mechanically ventilated, received dialysis, and is fully recovered and discharged from the hospital. So
that's good. And if people are leaving, we're recording the session, so please just don't walk right in front of the camera.
Hi. So that's exactly my question. I think ECMO, pretty obvious.
Right.
I think management of diarrhea, pretty straightforward. What I'm charged with, and I'm sure there's a lot of other people that are pulmonary critical care docs that are charged with, is what is the risk of offering intubation? What is the risk of transmission with the mechanical ventilator? What is the risk with dialysis? What I'm trying to create is a bucket of high risk, right, low risk, easy to offer,
sure,
more difficult to offer. That it trying to bridge between taking care of someone with multi-organ failure and keeping them safe.
Yeah.
So in terms of the airway, honestly, as we know, most of the infection control data on airway management is not there. But what I would recommend is just be a logical person, right? So if you see that someone already has a fair amount of oxygenation needs, in our institution, we're not going to do vapotherm or non-invasive ventilation as temporizer because of the unknown risk of aerosolizing, but more importantly, because we don't want to crash intubation. What vapotherm allows for is someone to get fairly sick and still being managed non-invasively, and when they crash, right? So if you see someone who's has escalating oxygenation requirements and you think that there's a fair chance they're going to go for mechanical ventilation, you don't need to be the hero to keep them off the ventilator. I think the logical thing is do it early, do it choreographed, do it controlled. We would paralyze, so we don't expect, we don't want someone coughing at the time of intubation. And that is not the time to give someone who doesn't manage airways that often the chance to do so. It should be skilled providers. And I would say do your briefing in the morning. you should actually have a day to know in advance to know if you're going to go on to intubation.
Yes.
In the morning, you do your briefing, you do your goals. This is how we're going to do the intubation. Here's everyone's roles and responsibilities. Here's going to be, if we can't get it, what our next step is going to be, et cetera. But I think that, personally, in our institution, I think that's absolutely within the scope of care. I think we should be able to provide, but we don't take it lightly. Michael can talk to their dialysis.
Yeah, that's a good question. So, you know, I remind everybody that ECMO is simply glorified dialysis, right, just with bigger cannulae. So there certainly is some risk of providing dialysis. So we, you will shortly see a manuscript talking about safety issues with dialysis, which is the background behind the CDC guidelines. Unfortunately, it's stuck in CDC clearance. They published their guidelines before I could publish the data behind the guidelines. We thought very highly about that, and so because of that, we made some very clear decisions, right? We needed to do something that was safe. We didn't want to have additional staff going into the room by doing hemodialysis, so our ICU nurses could run CRRT, so we let them take care of that. We wanted to maximize filter life so that they didn't have to break into the catheter very much. They would hook it up once every 3 days. And the effluent should not, and at least in our testing, preliminary testing is not infectious, but we still handled it carefully, but people don't have to be as worried about that.
So I'm going to have to.
There's a lot more I can talk about dialysis, we can talk about after the session, but I completely agree that they can all be provided safely.
Actually, I'm just going to have to cut it there because we're at the end of our hour, so thank you to our panel.